Good morning, church family. Very nice, Mr. Lucky. I can always count on you for sunshine in my life, if not in my eyes with that shirt. And mine too, that's Oh, good morning, church family. I'm so glad you're here on this Sabbath morning. All those who are in the hall, please come on in and join us. I have a few announcements to point out to you. I know that you are all capable of reading, but sometimes in our busy lives, we may scan the reading and not really internalize it. So I want to point out a few things. On number two, there will be the kids' Christmas cantata practice. The children for the cantata are singing again this year. And is this the first practice, Lisa? This is the first practice for the kids' cantata songs, and it will meet at 1:30 today in the kindergarten room. Where is that going to meet today? In the kindergarten room at 1:30. Okay, for the kids' Christmas cantata practice. On number five, the Wednesday night Bible studies will be resuming again, or the Wednesday afternoon, excuse me, the Wednesday afternoon. See, I can't read. I need you to help me. The Wednesday afternoon Bible studies will be resuming at 2 o'clock, and that will be here at the church. The Monday night Bible studies are also resuming. That starts at 7 to 8 each Monday night here at the church, and they are going to be on the topic of nurturing a passion for prayer. So please don't hesitate to join the Monday night Bible studies here at the church at 7 o'clock. I want to, on number 14, Rose Drake sends her appreciation for the steps of Christ. She's had many paperback copies over the years and that she has given away, so she is thankful to have this special copy from us. Dwayne Lee is at home recovering from heart surgery, and Carol is due to have surgery in a few weeks. Please continue to lift the Lee family up in our prayers. They've had a lot of trials, but with God's help, we can all get through our trials, including the Lee family can get through theirs. Donna Cox is still in the nursing home recovering from knee surgery. So please keep her in your prayers, and she wouldn't mind a phone call. The phone number is right there in the bulletin. It's not hard to find. And she would love to hear from her church family to see how she's doing. Now, there's one announcement that is not in your church in your church bulletin. So this one you need to listen to. The next church social is going to be October 27. That's at the end of this month, October 27 at 6 p.m. And it's going to be at James Arkaczynski's house. Has everybody been there? Has somebody been there? That's right. Somebody's been there. It's a wonderful place. I think there's about 15 acres, and there's woods and a pond and land and a nice house. It's a lovely place to be. The directions to his house will be on the kiosk out in the back afterwards. And on October 27th, at his house, there's going to be a bonfire and a hayride. Bring your lawn chairs, your marshmallow roasting sticks, flashlights. The s'mores, hot chocolate, and hot cider will be provided by the social committee. But if you want more than that, you can bring hot dogs, bun, potato salads, whatever, to make a potluck picnic. So the social committee is bringing the drink and the s'mores. If you want more, you bring it, and we'll all have a wonderful time. And it's Saturday night, October, does anybody remember? 27, that's right. And what time? 6 o'clock. Very good. And you will be hearing more about that, but I wanted you to get that on your calendars. Welcome to Sabbath, church family. I'm glad you're here, and I pray that you will have a Sabbath blessing today as we worship together.
Pink and blue sunglasses. Two colors, two views.
Male and female communication. It is a fun topic. It is a fun topic. She says, I have nothing to wear. What she means is she has nothing new. He says, I have nothing to wear. What he means is he has nothing clean. I liken it to the fact that God made women to look at the world through pink sunglasses. and it colors what she sees. In fact, I don't know if you know it, but she has pink hearing aids. It affects what she hears. And in fact, she speaks through a pink megaphone. Men, on the other hand, wear blue sunglasses and have blue hearing aids and speak through a blue megaphone. So, for instance, if that woman is among 10 women and she says, "I have nothing to wear," she speaks that through her pink megaphone. All 10 women who are listening through their pink hearing aids knows exactly what she meant by what she said. "Oh, honey, I don't have anything new either, but we're going shopping in a few minutes. You want to come down with us?" If that guy is speaking to 10 guys through his blue megaphone and they're listening through their blue hearing aids, "I don't have anything to wear," they'll all say, "She ain't doing your laundry either."
Come to the Love and Respect Marriage Conference. We'll share the secret that cracks the communication code between husbands and wives.
Good morning. Can anybody relate? Yes. We do speak differently, don't we? We want to invite you. Our church is hosting a Love and Respect seminar, and we want to invite everybody to come. It's going to be November 3rd and 4th. It's a Saturday evening and a Sunday morning. We're going to start Saturday evening about 5:45 and go to 9 o'clock, and then Sunday morning will be 8:45 to 1:30 in the afternoon. And this seminar is an awesome seminar. Mike and I were able to go to St. Louis and actually see Emerson and his wife Sarah in person. They travel around doing the seminar, but in order to duplicate themselves, they do it on DVD also. So that's what we're going to have here. So it's going to be a conference format. Everybody that enrolls will receive their own workbook that you can fill out as you go along. There's no spill your guts type thing, anything like that. It's just an awesome seminar. In fact, when Emerson was on Focus on the Family in 2003, that program received the most feedback that in the history of Focus on the Family. It's a very balanced program, and I've heard men say, "They're not picking on me," you know? It's just something that men and women can both relate, and it's just very, very good. So I really hope that you guys will mark your calendars, plan to intend, invite your friends, whether they're single, whether they're dating, married for a short time, married for a long time, whatever it is, we want to fill this church because, as all of you know, Satan is attacking marriages. He's attacking families, and that's how he can really get to the heart of our relationship with him too. God wants our marriages to reflect his image. And this seminar is just beautifully put. He bases a lot of it on Ephesians 6, and it's just awesome. So I really, really hope you guys will plan to attend. Invite all your friends. We'll have registration forms in the back. You do have to register. We need pre-registration. We are actually on, if you go to the Love and Respect website, it will refer you to our church website. So anybody that goes to the Love and Respect website anywhere in the area, they can attend our conference. And so we're hoping it to be a very nice outreach to the community and provide something for them. So you do need to register. It's $25 for a single and $40 for a couple. So it's very inexpensive. So hope to see you guys there. Thank you.
Please stand and join us in singing our hymn of praise this morning. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. boys and girls, it's time for your special part. In our service this morning, bring your baskets and fill them with all the bills, $5, $1, $10, it doesn't matter. Mr. Dave has a special story for you this morning.
Good morning, kids and young people. How are you today? Do any of you know what a parable is? What is a parable? It's a story, but it has what at the end? A meaning. It has a special point, a moral. It teaches a lesson. Well, I have a very short parable this morning, and I would like to read it to you because I only saw it last night for the first time when I wrote it. So anyway. "Go to Troas," Paul had said, "for God has put it in my head that we all need to visit there and tell the people of his care." So off he went with Luke and Tim aboard a boat that carried him across the waters to the beach and then to town so he could teach. Lots of people came to see this famous friend of Timothy. He'd laugh and tell the children of his friend called Jesus and his love. Now on the night of which I speak, he'd been there just about a week. Paul was preaching late that night, and in the room, the lamps were bright. All the kids were yawning, though. Their bedtimes happened long ago. The parents all were tired, right? But they hid their yawns, because that's polite. But Paul kept preaching on and on, because we'd be leaving after dawn, be on the boat down at the dock. And so he didn't watch the clock. Now, in a window in that room sat Eutychus in shadowed gloom. I do not know the reason why he sat there all alone, because I would have my kid sit next to me instead of snoozing noisily, for Eutychus was snoring loud. He could be heard by half the crowd. When suddenly, and this is weird, that little boy just disappeared. For sound asleep, he toppled out three stories down, or just about. We all ran down and found him dead, because he had landed on his head. But Paul arrived and hugged him tight and said, "This boy'll be all right." And up he jumped, that Eutychus. It really was miraculous. Then back upstairs we went and ate a snack, because it was all so late. Then after we had had our break, Paul preached because we were wide awake and wanted no more accidents. Then in the morning, off he went. Now, if you want to get the facts, they're in the Bible, the book of Acts, in chapter 20. It's all true, this story I just told to you. So what are we to learn today? Ask Eutychus what he would say. Be careful on what ledge you perch, and never, ever sleep in church. All right, you can go back to your seats.
God blessed you? I feel very blessed. Did you know that God has given us everything that we have, including our talents and the abilities to work and earn an income? And of all the things that he's given us, he has only asked that we return to him 10%, which is our tithe. That 10% never belonged to us. He lent it to us for just a short time, and we should return it. But did you know from all the blessings that he gives us, we should freely give? And those things that we freely give are our offerings. Today's offering is for church budget. And as we sit here in this beautiful building, this is God's house. Did you also know that God's house should not be left in debt? As you might be aware, we are in debt, and we need you to return your blessings as God has blessed to fill that need. And I ask today, as we take up this offering for church budget, that you give freely as God has freely given to you. I'll ask now the deacons to stand. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, we come before you today and we are blessed. You have given us without measure. Even the breath that we take is from you, and we do thank you for that. We ask now, as our hearts and minds prepare for the service, that we will overflow with gratitude and return to you our offerings. Be with us now as we prepare for the services. We ask in your name.
Thank you, Christopher. I'm here to welcome you this morning and relieve a little panic. Now, I've just had my own panic relieved, and Dan McMillan's panic has been slightly relieved. The pastor is in the house. But I would like to welcome you all this morning, and we have some minor preliminaries to take care of, but I'm going to let the pastor do that after our special music. So welcome, and he will be here after the special music, and we'll proceed as normal.
always reluctant to get up here. I want to make sure I'm not out of turn or let somebody else go if they want to. Our scripture this morning is from 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 21. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophecies. Test all things. Hold fast what is good. As far as possible, would you kneel with me as we pray? Heavenly Father, hallowed be thy name. Thank you, Father, this day for so much, for the day and for your love, for this beautiful church we have to come and gather with your family and friends in. Be with us, we pray. Lord, send your spirit to watch over us. Be especially with those in special needs. Be with those who are hurting physically and mentally. Strengthen them, Lord, and help them to know that you are there, that they may be going through dark times, but that you are there. Give us the strength to understand that. Be especially with the pastor as he presents his sermon today. Help him to present it so that we will understand it and draw closer to thee. Be with us this afternoon. Watch over our families and friends, we pray. Lord, in your precious name we ask. Amen.
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that flushed her face. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, "There's no place here for her kind." Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard, as she poured her love for the Master from her box of alabaster. Oh, Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of his touch. And now I'm giving back to him all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. And I've come to pour.
Good morning. It has been an interesting morning for me. My car died when I was on my way over. I've had numerous technical difficulties, but you know what? God's still on the throne. The day is going to be a wonderful day. We're going to enjoy a message together from God's Word in spite of the extra stresses I've had in my life. I feel His peace right now. Many times when things like this happen, I just get jittery and feel like my life's falling apart, but I honestly feel okay. We still may not have slides this morning. What's the latest, Dan?
Working on it.
Working on it, okay. Okay. If he catches up with me once I get rolling, that'll be fine. If we don't have any slides, take good notes. There's no way you'll keep up with your Bible with the numerous verses that I intended to cover on the screen today. But if you'll take some notes, I want you to check me out. Never take anything for granted that anyone says when they preach the Word of God. And that certainly applies to me. So please take good notes. There will be some verses I would encourage you to look up, and that will be the ones when we look at some tests. And those tests will be clear when I get to that part of my message. Let me just say one additional prayer momentarily. Father God, thank you for the blessing of your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the peace that your presence brings, even when life feels it's in turmoil. Thank you for your love for us and your promise to guide us and to teach us all things and to bring all things to our remembrance, whatever you've told us before. We praise you for your blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, we're going to refer back to a message that I shared last Wednesday night called Revelation's Survivors. And that subject covered the remnant church, God's remnant people, as they are described in Revelation, the 12th chapter. The remnant of her seed. We saw that the seed of the woman, Jesus Christ, his followers would also be called his seed and also described as the woman of Bible prophecy, a pure woman, the pure woman of Revelation 12. Three high points that we covered are, number one, these people are described as commandment-keeping Christians in Revelation 12, 17 and Revelation 14, 12. We also discovered that God's last day church, his movement of prophecy, would also be preaching three special messages that we find in Revelation chapter 14. We call them the three angels' messages we've been studying in our seminar so far. And then finally, we also identified a characteristic that I'm going to expand on today. And that's found in Revelation 12, 17. God's people were described as, in verse 17 of Revelation 12, Here are they. You'll want to look this one up. Take a peek at this before we get rolling here. Revelation 12:17. And since I expected to have the screen, I don't have page numbers. If you have a seminar Bible, someone who has a seminar Bible will politely shout that out when you find it. Revelation 12:17. That should be easy to find, last book of the Bible. 650. Okay. Here the Bible says, "And the dragon was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring," or the remnant of her seed in the King James, "who keep the commandments of God," and what else? "Have the testimony of Jesus." Now, we made reference to this, and it is an appropriate application. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy, as we'll see in just a moment. God's people would be proclaiming a prophetic message from the Bible. They would declare, as Paul did, all the counsel of God. They would not shun to declare to the world all the counsel of God, including what the prophets have to say. Amen? But it goes farther than this. Notice with me Revelation 19:10. Revelation 19:10. Here, the Bible says, this is John. He falls down at the feet of an angel, and I probably would be constrained to do the same as would you, because of the majestic presence of a supernatural being, but God doesn't want us to worship angels, does he? And he didn't want John to worship an angel. The angel reminds him of this in verse 10. He says, "I fell at his feet to worship him, but he said to me, 'See that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant and of your brethren who have,'" what? "The testimony of Jesus. Worship God." Then he'll tell us what the testimony of Jesus is. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. In other words, the gift of prophecy. Now, that will get clearer in chapter 22, verse 9. Look at chapter 22 of Revelation, verse 9. The angel presents himself in front. There we go. Praise God. Revelation 22, verse 9. Here the angel presents himself before John once again. And he repeats a similar warning, not to worship him, but he says the previous phrase that we found in chapter 19:10 in just a little bit different way. He says, "See that you do not do that, for I am your fellow servant and of your brethren, the prophets." Very clear here. So the spirit of prophecy is clearly the gift of prophecy, and those who keep the words of this book, he says, worship God. So the testimony of Jesus is what? What is it? It's the spirit of prophecy, the gift of prophecy, in other words. So one of the identifying marks of God's remnant church, his last day people, the last day movement giving his message, will be they have the gift of prophecy manifest among them. Now, I've already mentioned that the church teaches prophecy, but here clearly is another application of that very important concept of the spirit of prophecy. It is the gift of prophecy in our modern times. Notice how Paul uses this same, I want to clarify it one more time, from another New Testament passage. This is 1 Corinthians 1:5-7. It's on the screen. Paul uses the same terminology, the testimony of Christ, when he describes the prophetic gift. Notice that "you were enriched," he says to the Corinthians, "in everything by him in all utterance and knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you." In other words, the prophetic gift was manifest at Corinth, he says. Notice verse 7, "so that you come short in no gift, eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ." Notice, the church, Paul says, is not to come short of any gift as they anticipate and long for the second coming of Jesus. Is prophecy one of the spiritual gifts listed in the Bible? Absolutely. So we should expect the church would not come short in this gift either. What are the gifts, by the way? Well, make a note. We don't have these on the screen, and there's no time to cover all of this, but it's kind of easy to remember. They're identical chapters and a multiple of these numbers. Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12, and Ephesians 4 are the primary passages of the New Testament that describe spiritual gifts. When Jesus ascended up to heaven, he blessed the church with the gift of the Spirit, and when the Spirit was poured out, all sorts of wonderful gifts were given to the church to help them be effective at spreading the gospel in evangelism, as well as building up the church itself, edifying, strengthening the body of Christ. Notice Ephesians 4, verse 8 and onward. By the way, If you are a believer in Jesus Christ and you have received the Holy Spirit, you have been gifted somehow for God's work. There's some sort of a spiritual gift that God wants you to use to His glory. In this church, we have some tools and seminars that we have prepared and we experience occasionally. And we even have a website that you might like to find out about that will help you discover your spiritual gift and find some ways to put that gift to use. In Ephesians 4:8, the Bible says, when He ascended on high, He led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. These are the spiritual gifts. Now, what kind of gifts? Notice verse 11. He Himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets. There it is. Some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Notice carefully the duration of the gifts. How long they would be manifest in the church? Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure and stature of the fullness of Christ. How long does the church need the gifts manifest in their midst? Well, let me ask that another way. How long will the church need unity? How long will the church need knowledge? How long will the church need maturity? Will there ever be a time we don't need those blessings in the church? Then that's just the amount of time we need spiritual gifts to function, and that's why they're promised all the way up till Jesus returns. That's exactly what Paul is telling us in his passages. Now, as we look at the gifts, it's easy to notice most of these are widely accepted. Most of them are widely accepted in every Christian church, except for prophecy. Except for prophecy. Why would that be? Well, when you look at the subject of prophecy in our world today, you will notice some things. Just in a general sense, you will notice a multitude of people who proclaim to have this special gift. Anyone from palm readers to astrologers. In fact, more than 2,000 of our nation's newspapers run a column supposedly based upon either astrological principles or some gifted person who's able to foretell the future. Books sell by the thousands every year on related subjects of special manifestations of a supposed prophetic gift or foreknowledge. Perhaps this is one of the reasons that the church is reticent to recognize the gift of prophecy. The church doesn't want to be associated with the bizarre, the strange, or the weird, right? Yeah. But there's another reason. Jesus' clear warning, very clear warning in Matthew 24:24. He's speaking of the last days in Matthew 24, where he says, false Christ and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, the elect. There it is, someone says. Jesus warned against false prophets. That's why we should be safe and secure and recognize there won't be any more prophets since biblical times. Not so fast. Jesus also warned in Matthew 24 against false Christs. Does that mean there is no valid Christ? Because he warned that there would be false Christ? Not at all. And in the same vein of thought, just because Jesus warns of false Christ by no means means that there wouldn't be any real, just because he warned against false prophets doesn't mean that he intended that there would be no true prophets before his second coming or sometime after the biblical canon or scripture was finished. Besides that, you do realize, why would there be so many false prophets if Satan himself didn't expect that there would be a genuine to counterfeit? Remember the principle that we learned from the Bible? That Satan specializes in counterfeiting the work of God. He studied the prophecies in the Bible carefully. You can be sure of that. And he is out to deceive. And so that's why he multiplies so many would-be or supposed prophets in our day. This may be a new thought to many of you in the room today, but did you know that there were several prophets mentioned by name in the Bible who were not an author of a book of the Bible? Did you know that? They're mentioned by name. Let me just mention a few. Acts 13, verse 1. This should be on the screen. This is in the New Testament, too, by the way. Now in the church that was at Antioch, there were certain prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manian, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. These were all prophets clearly mentioned in the New Testament. And here's another shocker for you. women as well. New Testament, women. Philip the evangelist. Listen what the Bible says in the book of Acts about Philip's daughters. It says, this man had four virgin daughters who prophesied. We see clearly that both men and women prophesied in the New Testament. Now, we've never seen a book of the Bible written by Philip's daughters, have we? We don't have a book of the Bible or a letter in the New Testament called Simeon or Lucius of Niger or any of these other names that were mentioned there, and yet clearly the Bible identified them as prophets. Apparently, in God's wisdom, there's different roles and functions for his prophets in the New Testament time. Some of them had a local regional role, and their influence was needed in the church, but for some reason, their writings were not written down as if they were a book of the Bible. So it indicates there's different kinds of manifestation of the prophetic gift. Why would it disappear, one might ask? Why would the prophetic gift dry up and disappear? Well, for the very same reason that it did in Old Testament times. Were you aware that it dried up at certain periods of time in Old Testament history as well? Listen to what the Bible says about it. It gives us some clear indications as to why. Jeremiah chapter 26, verse 4. Jeremiah 26, verse 4. Yes, I do have this on the screen. And you shall say to them, thus says the Lord, if you will not listen to me to walk in my law, which I have set before you, to heed the words of my servants, the prophets, whom I sent to you, both rising early and sending them, but you have not heeded, then I will make this house like Shiloh and will make this city a curse to all the nations of the earth. First of all, I want you to notice, listen to his appeal through his prophets. He says, you're not listening. You're not listening to my law, and you're not listening to my prophets. This starts the track of an interesting study. Notice Lamentations 2, verse 9 now. This is what God says about Jerusalem when they, again, they are persisting in resisting. The Bible says, her gates have sunk into the ground. He has destroyed and broken her bars. Her king and her princes are among the nations. The law is no more. And her prophets, what happens to the prophets? Find no vision from the Lord. There's a hint, a real strong hint. When the law of God is neglected, the gift of prophecy dries up, folks. Here's another one, Ezekiel 20, verse 3. Son of man, speak to the elders of Israel and say to them, thus says the Lord God, have you come to inquire of me? As I live, says the Lord God, I will not be inquired of by you. Why? We find that in verses 8 to 13, and I don't think I have that on the screen, but listen carefully. Why? They rebelled against me and would not obey me. That's why he would not be inquired of by them. They did not cast all the way their abominations which are before their eyes, nor did they forsake the idols of Egypt. Then I said, I will pour out my fury on them and fulfill my anger against them in the midst of the land of Egypt. It's interesting, a specific command was being neglected. One of God's Ten Commandments was blatantly neglected and broken by his people. We find it in verse 12. He says, moreover also, I gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord who sanctifies them. They had ignored his Sabbath, and the prophetic gift had dried up. In verse 13, he says, yet the house of Israel rebelled against me in the wilderness. They would not walk in my statutes. They despise my judgments, which if a man does, he'll live by them. And they greatly defiled my Sabbaths. So do you get it? When neglect of God's law, rebellion against God's law, and ignoring his prophets, when that takes place, the prophetic gift dries up. We have Old Testament examples of that. Should we expect that God's going to somehow function differently in New Testament time? His character is the same in the Old Testament, just as it is in the New Testament. So let me ask you a question. What would happen if there is a revival among God's people? They turn their hearts to the Lord Jesus in repentance, confess their sins, repent of those sins, turn away from breaking his commandments, including the Sabbath, and are hungry to hear the word of the Lord. What do you think the Lord might do then? Can you guess? Well, if it dries up when we neglect and rebel, what would happen if we repent and obey? Yeah, God's going to respond differently. He's anxious to communicate with those who really want to know. And so in Revelation 12, 17, the Bible tells us the dragon was wroth with the woman, means he was angry, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God So here's a people again, restoring neglected truth, the commandments of God, including the Sabbath. And what does God do? He restores the gift, the testimony of Jesus Christ, which we've seen clearly is the spirit of prophecy. So God's word declares he will have a people in the last generation who, again, are commandment keepers. They restore the Sabbath truth, which prophecy predicted in the book of Isaiah and numerous other places. And God would also respond by instructing and helping his people with the gift that he blessed his people with anciently. And that is the gift of prophecy, a very clear spiritual gift. The Bible says the Holy Spirit would gift the church with prophecy, and it tells us not to despise prophecy. Listen to this admonition from the Apostle Paul in this epistle, 1 Thessalonians 5, 19-21. He says, "Do not quench the Spirit." When the Holy Spirit wants to be active among his people and we resist or restrain that, that's not a good thing. We're going to lose if we hold back on what God wants to do. He continues and he says, specifically about prophecy, "Do not despise prophecies." Listen, there's many Christians today. You even mention a hint of the idea that there could be a modern prophet, and you know what they're going to say? "Oh, that's crazy. That's impossible. That's fanatical kind of stuff. Stay away from that." And yet the Bible says, do not despise prophecies. In verse 21, he does give this warning, though. "Test all things. Hold fast what is good." Now, that's wise counsel, because if there's thousands, and there are, of people who profess to be prophets of the Lord, we had best test them if we don't want to be led astray. Amen? So John echoes a similar warning in his epistle, 1 John 4:1. He tells us clearly, "Do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world." What if we want to avoid being deceived by a false prophet, he tells us, just like Paul, to put them to the test. Test the spirits, try them, see if they are from the Lord. How do we do that? There are more than five, but I'm going to give you five what I believe are rock-solid biblical tests of the gift of prophecy. You examine these five, you'll have enough to know, but you can probe around and find some others if you study your Bible carefully. But let me give you five this morning. Test number one, and you're going to have to look these up. I just did not have time or room to crowd in more into my schedule, but you'll find these easily. Numbers, Old Testament book of Numbers, chapter 12, verse 6. This is test number one. At least write it down. Numbers 12, verse 6. Here the Bible says, "And he said, hear now my words, if there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision, and will speak unto him in a dream." All right? The first thing I would like to encourage you to recognize from the Bible is visions and dreams are God's method of communicating with a prophet. Now, to some of you, that seems very elementary, but it's an important principle to remember. May I remind you, there's a lot of people in the world today that profess to be prophets of God, but they use things like tarot cards, crystal balls, and astrology in what they do. That does not harmonize with the Scripture whatsoever. The Bible says visions and dreams. That's how God communicates with prophets. By the way, did you know God even warns against listening? Not only people practicing, but people listening to people who say they are prophets and use that other methodology, astrology, tarot cards, crystal balls, etc. Jot down Isaiah 47, verse 13. There's bad news associated with that sort of quote-unquote prophecy. Now, if the Lord is sending a vision or a dream to a prophet, that tells us right away on test number one, they are not supposed to be sharing their own ideas. They obtain their information from the Lord. Now, there's more we could expand on in that. Let me just throw out this seed for thought for you. You'll notice a great difference of literary style among biblical prophets. God did not dictate to prophets word for word their messages. Please get that idea out of your head. Just read the various books of the Bible. You'll see, how could it be one God with such a variant style of writing? It's because he didn't bypass their intelligence, their culture, and their life habits and education in order to communicate his message. He gave them a message, and then he guided them as they chose the words under his inspirative guidance, under his inspiration and guidance, that is, to write down the messages that he would have them deliver. So they don't share their own ideas. It's a message from the Lord. Let's look at an example in Acts chapter 11, verses 27 and 28 of the two kinds of revelations I referred to earlier. Some wrote a book of the Bible, others did not. Listen to Acts 11, verses 27 to 28. Here it says, "And in these days prophets came from Jerusalem to Antioch. Then one of them named Agabus stood up and showed by the Spirit that there was going to be a great famine throughout all the world, and also it also happened in the days of Claudius Caesar." So here we had a prophet that God revealed, either in a vision or a dream, somehow to them, an event that was to take place. And even though we don't have a book of Agabus written in the Bible, we certainly have a prophet named here, and he shared a message that literally came true. So test number one is the prophet will have visions and dreams, or visions or dreams. And based on that, we know it's a message from God. It's not their own ideas that they're sharing. Test number two, a prophet is always 100% accurate according to the Bible. They have to be 100% accurate or they're not a prophet. So a true prophet does not guess. He doesn't have a percentage of correctness. It has to be 100% or he's not a prophet. Deuteronomy 18, verses 20 to 22. Deuteronomy 18, verses 20 to 22. "The prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die." Verse 21, "And if you say in your heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? How will we not be deceived by a false prophet, Lord?" His answer, "When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord," listen carefully, "if the thing does not happen or come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord has not spoken, and that prophet has spoken it presumptuously. You shall not be afraid of him." So the prediction must come to pass if it is a prophet of God. Notice Jeremiah 28, verse 9, "As for the prophet who prophesies of peace, when the word of the prophet comes to pass, the prophet will be known as the one whom the Lord has truly sent." So if it doesn't come to pass, they're not a true prophet. Have no fear of them. If it does come to pass, he says through Jeremiah, then you can know that is a prophet of the Lord. Now, this point alone does away with most of the would-be prophets in our world today. Take, for example, you ever heard of Nostradamus? Very popular name when it comes to prophecy. 449 major prophecies. Out of those, only 18 were wrong. Not bad odds, is it? But he's not batting 100. But I need to tell you something else. 390 of those prophecies that he made have absolutely no application in any time, place, or experience. There's just nothing identifiable, clearly, that has happened in history that are related to those prophecies. So that drops him down to a 9% success rate. That's not too good, is it? How about Jean Dixon? She's been around for years. 30% accurate? That is what some experts who have studied Jean Dixon's predictions have come up with. Was she wrong the other 70% of the time? Yeah, evidently so. Is God wrong that often? Not according to his word. So if God is in it, he says it has to be 100% accurate. But I must interject one thing. There is such a thing as conditional prophecy. So you must rule that into the equation. Conditional prophecy, if you weren't here last night, I'll repeat a good example of that. Jonah went to Nineveh, and he said, in so many days, this city is going to be utterly destroyed. Was it? No. Was he a false prophet? No. He was an angry prophet. He was mad at the Lord when God didn't destroy the city like he predicted. That makes me look like a fool. And he went and pouted about it for a while. And God said, what do you think's better, basically? I'm paraphrasing, you know, to be accurate in your prediction and save face, or those thousands of people that I love and I really don't want to see destroyed? They repented. That's why I spared them. So we must factor in sometimes conditional prophecy. Now, test number three, Deuteronomy 13, verses 1 through 4. Deuteronomy 13, verses 1 through 4. Here, the Lord gives us another test. Deuteronomy 13, verses 1 through 4. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Old Testament. If there arises among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and he gives you a sign or a wonder, and the sign or wonder comes to pass of which he spoke to you, saying, let us go after other gods, which we've not known, and let us serve them. So now, did you catch this? He makes an accurate prediction, and the prediction that he makes comes to pass. But then he says, let's go worship idols. Or let's worship other gods rather than the Lord. The Lord responds and says, you shall not listen to the words of that prophet or dreamer of dreams, for the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you will love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. You shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and you shall serve him and hold fast to him. So in other words, even if they have accurate predictions, if they tell you to disobey the word of God as revealed in the Bible, forget it. Even though you've seen a supernatural event take place, that does not mean that they are working for the Lord, because one of the Lord's prophets would never turn you away from the scriptures. That's exactly what Isaiah warns against in Isaiah 8:20. I have this one on the screen. Here's the test. To the law and the testimony, if they do not speak according to this word, that's basically the law and the prophets, folks. If they do not speak according to this word, it is because there is how much light in them? No light in them. They are not of the Lord. So we should expect, if it's a true prophet of God, they will not neglect to declare even painful statements that might even cost them their lives or shame or humiliation or the anger of people that they are reproving. Like Elijah on Mount Carmel, facing off with a whole nation and the leadership of the church in those days that had turned from the Lord, he plainly declared to them their sins and did not hold back what the Lord told him to say. John the Baptist reproved a political leader in his day for adultery. Fearlessly, he proclaimed that before him. And later, he was shut up in prison because the lady that Herod was having an affair with hated John. He suffered for it, but he did not neglect to declare everything the Bible said and everything the Lord would have him say. This is a very important point. The Bible tells us that we could even be tested on this very point in that scripture. It's wise to remember, Satan has some degree of control so far as God permits over events in this world. God supersedes all of that, but Satan has limited control of some things in the Bible. According to the Bible, he has limited control of some events in our lives. And what if one of his servants, Satan's servants, makes a prediction, and then Satan and his angels work out in detail in the future many of those events to deceive people into thinking that it is a true prophet? That's exactly the type of scheming that Satan is up to. Let's move on to test number four. So the last test has to be according to the scripture, right? Even if they make accurate predictions, but they are not in harmony with the Bible, you can know it's not a prophet of God. I'm going to show you a list of all five when I finish this segment. Number four, the fruits of a prophet's ministry will reveal whether they are really of God or not. The fruits, in other words, the results of their ministry. When their prophetic gift functions, what happens around them? Does it build up and edify the church, or is it destructive? Matthew 7, verses 16 to 20, Jesus tells us this about fruit. Matthew 7, 16 to 20. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? How about it? When you go out in the garden, you expect to find the kind of fruit that the vine is, right? So it is with a prophet or a believer. Even so, every good tree brings forth good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. By their fruits, you will know them. So what are the results of their ministry? Is it edifying? Does it build up? Does the church flourish under their influence and prophetic gift when it's manifested? Or does the opposite happen? Does it tear down and bring confusion? For more information on this one, I would advise you to read 1 Corinthians 14, verses 3 and 4. 1 Corinthians 14, verses 3 and 4. Just jot that one down. Further support for number 4. What is their fruit? Does it edify? Test number 5. Here's the last one. God sometimes, this is not always, but sometimes God gives supernatural indications when the prophetic gift is functioning. Now, it's very important to remember all the other tests, because just because they're supernatural phenomena, and I've seen some video of some pretty strange stuff that I do not believe meets the Bible test at all, but it really did happen. I mean, people falling on rocks gently backwards. No one is visible there when they do this falling, and their eyes are straight up, and they can stay on course when their eyes are straight, are rolled back in their head and their heads are straight up. I've seen some examples of this, but when you put the other four tests upon these would-be prophets, they just don't match up with what the Bible gives as these other tests. But I do want you to know, sometimes God uses the supernatural to draw the church's attention to his speaking, to recognize something supernatural is happening, and he seeks to give some validation in this method. Daniel is an example of a prophet who manifested, as did other prophets, some supernatural phenomena. Daniel chapter 10, verses 15 to 18. Daniel 10, verses 15 to 18. You'll find this one very, you want to look at this in your Bible. Daniel 10, 15 to 18. This is very, very interesting. Supernatural phenomena. Hey, we're kind of into that stuff, aren't we? And people have always been. You remember, to Jesus, that's all they wanted from Jesus, those that wouldn't believe. Well, show us a sign, and then we'll believe. You know, we just love this kind of stuff. Well, here's what God gave through Daniel, or gave to Daniel as a supernatural manifestation. It says in verse 15, Daniel 10, "When he had spoken such words to me, I turned my face toward the ground and became speechless. And suddenly, one having the likeness of the sons of men touched my lips. Then I opened my mouth and spoke, saying to him who stood before me, 'My Lord, because of the vision, my sorrows have overwhelmed me, and I have retained no strength.'" So he's weak and apparently collapses. And then it says, "For how can this servant of my Lord talk with you, my Lord?" He was so weak, he couldn't even talk when the presence of this supernatural being came to him. "As for me, no strength remains in me now, nor is any breath left in me." He stopped breathing? Yes, he did. Yes, he did. This is clearly a supernatural manifestation, wouldn't you say? When breath is no longer, when someone is no longer breathing, that's kind of scary, right? And yet he remained alive. Verse 18, "Then again, the one having the likeness of a man touched me and strengthened me." So in spite of the fact that he was weak and not breathing, with this touch of the Lord's angel, he was strengthened and able to communicate and receive and share the vision. Stopping breathing, that's just bizarre, isn't it? Well, let's review, okay? Weakness, but supernaturally strengthened. No breath, and yet they continue to live. Here's five tests all in a row. If you didn't get a chance to get those tests, just look at them briefly and jot them down if you missed them. And I need to move on to review something else. I'll leave that slide up momentarily. Prophets were always, we're going to review, prophets were always active in the church. We've seen that, haven't we? Old Testament and New Testament. Number two, if God's people strayed from his commandments or ignored his prophets, God would remove the gift of prophecy. It would no longer function. Number three, we saw that the true church would keep God's commandments, would repent of those sins of the fathers, of turning away from God's commandments, and God would restore the gift of prophecy to those who choose to keep his commandments. And then finally, the fourth thing I want to review before we move on is that the only way to know a true prophet is to apply the biblical tests. This book is the acid test. Doesn't matter what kind of miracles they perform, doesn't matter what kind of supernatural phenomena takes place in their life, if they don't match the biblical tests, they are not a prophet of God. Now I'm going to share something with you that's going to be shocking to a number of people in the audience today. I believe that there is a clearly discernible modern manifestation of the gift of prophecy. Let me tell you a little bit about this interesting person. I by no means have any intent to absolutely convince you that you must believe as I do on this matter. But I want to stir your heart, stir your mind, and challenge you to investigate and look at the evidence for yourself. That's all a person can do. But here we go. In the early 1800s, as we've been studying, many Christians were studying the prophecies of the Bible, were anxious for the second coming of Christ. They discovered in Revelation chapter 14 that God, through the three angels' messages, was drawing attention, their attention, and he wanted the world's attentions riveted upon neglected truth in the world. And that neglected truth was his neglected commandments, especially the fourth commandment, the Sabbath of the Lord. It was during this time that a young lady born in 1827 named Ellen Harmon, who later married and is known as Ellen G. White, manifested what many people believe to be a prophetic gift, a genuine prophetic gift, at 17 years of age. One of the scriptures that convinced or at least stirred people to investigate this supernatural manifestation is found in Joel chapter 2, verses 28 and 29. It's on the screen. It shall come to pass afterward, and if you'll read this chapter carefully, it is in the context of the last days. I'm just quoting a small portion of it. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out of my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions, and also on my men servants and on who? My maid servants will I pour out my spirit in those days. God is not gender specific when it comes to the gift of prophecy. Men servants as well as maid servants may receive this prophetic gift. Ellen G. White did in fact have over 2,000 visions and dreams throughout her life. It's up to you to examine and find out, do you believe those are from the Lord or from something else? That falls on your shoulders. I can't persuade you of that. You have to look at the evidence. Early in her ministry, they often happened in public. The visions' duration were anywhere from just a few minutes to up to 4 hours in vision. The group of Christians that fellowshipped with Ellen G. White at this time were from all the major churches and denominations. There was no official Seventh-day Adventist church at this time, just people who were earnestly studying the scriptures, seeking for greater light and truth from the Bible. Now, many inside of this group, loosely called Adventists, not the Seventh-day Adventist church, it wasn't formed yet, they just were called Adventists because they believed in the soon coming of Jesus, they had begun to believe that God had restored the gift of prophecy in this young lady, Ellen G. White. Now, it is very important at this point, having introduced this concept to your minds, it is very important that I draw some lines. How would we know whether she or anyone else is a genuine prophet of God? How are we going to know? The acid test, and what is that? The Bible. The Bible. If she doesn't meet the test, reject her as any other prophet. And only you can apply those tests, and I would urge you, look for any other test you might find as you study your Bible carefully. In order for you to have some subject matter to test whether you believe these visions are from the Lord or not, I'm going to offer you some free books at the close of the meeting today. There'll be a variety of books, and if there's about three that I'll offer, but if there's enough to go around, you're welcome to all three of them. One of them will be an Old Testament exposition called Patriarchs and Prophets, lovely book. Commentary on the stories of the Old Testament, and the other one is The Great Controversy, which does a study of the history of the church from the Apostles' day till the present and applies many of the prophecies of the book of Daniel and Revelation. So get the material, and then you just take it apart and look at it and decide for yourself. It is also important to recognize the official stance of the Seventh-day Adventist Church regarding the writings of Mrs. White. May I quote from you? This is on the screen. The official belief, this is not my, I believe the same way, but the official stance of the Seventh-day Adventist Church is this. The writings of Ellen G. White are not, hear me loud and clear, are not a substitute for Scripture. Please forever put that lie out of your mind. We have been accused of that, and there might be some unbalanced but sincere people in our midst all over the world that are imbalanced on this point, but that is not the official stance of our church. It is not a substitute for the Scripture. They cannot be placed on the same level. The Holy Scriptures stand alone. Don't you like that? The unique standard by which her and all other writings must be judged and to which they must be subject, the Bible is the supreme standard. Amen? The Seventh-day Adventists fully support the Reformation principle of sola scriptura. That means the Bible and the Bible only. The Bible as its own interpreter and the Bible alone as the basis of all doctrines. Have I used Ellen G. White to try and prove anything to anyone in this audience the entire time I've had this series of meetings? It's been the Bible, hasn't it? All right? That is our stance as a church. Now, you'll find something that Ellen White herself says that led to that position, that firmed up that position, that gave credence to that position that we've taken as a church. Notice what she said in her day back in 1851. This is compiled from a few different sources. If you're really curious, I'll get you the originals, but just for sake of time, these are all directly her quotations, though. I recommend to you, dear reader, the word of God as the rule of your faith and practice. By that word we are judged. In his word, God has committed to men the knowledge necessary for salvation. The Holy Scriptures are to be accepted as an authoritative, infallible revelation of his will. They are the standard of character, the revealer of doctrines, the test of experience. Little heed is given to the Bible, therefore the Lord has given a, this is her terminology for her prophetic work, lesser light to lead men and women to the greater light, and that's the Bible. That was her position on the matter as well. She did not equate herself with Bible prophets, nor did she exalt her work above the Bible in any way, shape, or form. Today, thousands of people throughout the world, millions as a matter of fact by now, have tested her writings by the Bible and have been convicted by the Lord as they looked at the evidence that surely this is a gift from God. Now, here's a few episodes that you might find interesting in her life. Physical phenomena, supernatural phenomena, first of all, Parkville, Michigan, January 12, 1861. She went off into vision. There was a lot of skepticism at this time. There was a spiritualist physician who was present at those meetings, and he had been boasting beforehand, oh, she's just in a hypnotic trance, just like I can put people into it. I can bring her right out of it. She went into vision while he was there. He turned deathly pale, I'm quoting, shook like an aspen leaf. This is eyewitnesses at the scene. Shook like an aspen leaf. Elder White said, that's her husband, will the doctor please report her condition? He replied, she doesn't breathe, and rapidly made his way to the door. Those at the door knew of his boasting spirit and said, go back and do what you said you'd do. Bring this woman out of vision. In great agitation, he reaches for the door, but they wouldn't let him out until he made a statement. He said, and they said, doctor, what is it? He said, God only knows, let me out of this house. June 26, 1854, eyewitnesses again. Three people, their testimonies line up, they were there. Recall how two physicians were present on this occasion while Mrs. White was in vision. One of the doctors brought a mirror, placed it in front of her mouth so that obviously the breath coming out would fog the mirror. And he replies, she doesn't breathe. After examining her sides as she spoke, he could still find no evidence of breathing. Later, they put a lighted candle close to her lips without the slightest flicker. The physician reported, that settles it forever. There is no breath in her body throughout the duration of that vision. On another occasion, Ellen White was in family prayer. She stepped over to a bureau in the home and picked up an 18-pound Bible and held it at arm's length for nearly half an hour with no fatigue, while in vision, that is. She only weighed 80 pounds. On another occasion, eyewitnesses saw her hold a large Bible above her head. With one hand holding the Bible, her eyes lifted upward, but not at the Bible, and her finger, as she was in vision, sharing a message that they believed to be from the Lord, she pointed with the other finger, not looking at it, exactly, and they got up in a chair to check it out. Every verse that she was quoting, her finger was accurately pointing to that. Now, all I can tell you is that supernatural phenomena, you have to test whether you decide whether that's from the Lord or the other power. Do you know she said that at one time? She said, there's no middle ground on my work. It's either of God or it's of the devil. So you'll have to decide. In 1864, she said something that people then were laughing about in disbelief. Here's what she said. Tobacco is a poison of the most deceitful and malignant kind. Big deal, you say today. We've known that for a long time. Oh, but hear me carefully. Back in her day, when she wrote that, there were physicians prescribing tobacco smoke to cure lung ailments, if you can imagine that. And there was no official statement in our nation until 1957 that smoking was really hazardous to your health. How did she know that 90 years ahead of time when people were saying it's good for you? Ellen G. White has been quoted by professors, non-Adventists, professors, doctors, news commentators, and other world authorities in many different fields. This is an old quote, but nevertheless, it was a university professor at Cornell University, Dr. Clive McKay. This is from one of his articles. He says, the writings of Ellen G., he was not an Adventist, the writings of Ellen G. White have been cited because they provide a guide to nutrition that comprehends the whole body. You see, he saw scientific value in the statements that she had in her books on health. Now, how could she figure, I got one really interesting for you. How could she figure this one out? 1906, she makes this statement. I have been instructed that the X-ray is not the great blessing that some suppose it to be. If used unwisely, it may do much harm. Do you realize when the X-ray came out and was available for public use, at the county fair, for a few coins, you could line up and entertain your friends and family with X-rays of your bones. You could line up again and again and again. Can you imagine, especially with the amount of radiation you would be imbibing, can you imagine the risk you were at for cancer with that kind of practice? And yet, who told her so far ahead of time, before everyone else knew, that the X-ray, if it's used unwisely, would not prove to be such a great blessing? It's rather interesting, isn't it? How did she know? In 1893, she was talking about something that is really kind of cutting-edge stuff today. She was talking about the, I quote, the electrical force of the brain. The electrical force of the brain. It was years before that concept was studied and validated by modern science. Ellen White is the most translated female author in the entire world. She wrote 55,000 pages. She has her books total over 100. Her counsels on church administration, evangelism, marriage and the family, health and education have been and still prove to be a blessing to millions of people worldwide. Her counsel on education alone has led to the establishment of 4,000 grade schools worldwide, with 250 high schools and universities that are preparing young people to work for God. Fruit? That's some pretty positive fruit. I must say that the greatest blessing personally that I have received from reading her writings, yes, I do believe she has the prophetic gift, but I can't make that decision for you. You'll have to put it to the test. But here's my personal testimony. I can truly say that her book, Steps to Christ, has led me to a greater love for, deeper understanding and appreciation of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the heart of her message, folks, is the gospel of Christ. And, you know, though I had read many of the scriptures that she referred to when I read the book, I can honestly say after reading the book Steps to Christ repeatedly, when I open my Bible and read those same verses, they strike me in a much deeper, fuller way than I had ever imagined, and my appreciation of what the gospel means has been deepened intensely. Let me share my favorite statement. This is not on the screen. Just relax and listen quietly. I'm almost done. Page 62 of her book, Steps to Christ. Talk about the gospel. We have no righteousness of our own with which to meet the claims of the law of God. That's true, isn't it? But Christ has made a way of escape for us. He lived on earth amid trials and temptations such as we have to meet. He lived a sinless life. He died for us. And now he offers to take our sins and give us his righteousness. If you give yourself to him and accept him as your Savior, then as sinful as your life may have been, for his sake you are accounted righteous. Christ's character stands in place of your character, and you are accepted before God just as if you had not sinned. More than this, Christ changes the heart. He abides in your heart by faith. You are to maintain this connection with Christ by faith and the continual surrender of your will to him. So long as you do this, he will work in you to will and do of his good pleasure. You may say, the life which I now live, I live by faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me, Galatians 2:20. You cannot read any of her books without being inundated with Scripture. This book has literally led millions of people to assurance and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and I personally testify it has blessed me in my walk with Jesus myself. As you leave today, be sure that you pick up a copy of your choice of one of the books or more of that I'm offering. You're welcome to more than one, so long as there's enough to go around. Great Controversy, Patriarchs and Prophets are the main ones, and I'll have to slip into my office. I neglected to put out Steps to Jesus. It's a modern version of Steps to Christ. I'll make that available too. No doubt, you've heard things probably already, if you've done any investigation on the internet about Adventists, and the subject of Ellen White has come up. May I just offer one word of caution? I'm certainly not forbidding anyone to look at all the evidence, even the negative, if you choose to do that. That's fine. But please make sure that the information is accurate. And the only way that you can do that is go to the official website of the Ellen G. White Estate, who has legal charge of her writings and published works at this time. That is found at www.whiteestate.org. You will find a rebuttal to most of the heavy criticisms that are laid against her. As you might expect, if she is a true prophet, I believe she is, if she is, wouldn't you expect that there's going to be a lot of negative stuff attacking her if it's the work of the Lord? Absolutely you would. So you'll have to decide for yourself. All I would ask is that will you be willing, whether it's Ellen White or any other supposed prophet in modern time, because it's possible any time according to the Bible, will you apply the test the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5, 19 to 21? Will you choose to not quench the Spirit? God, if you want to speak in modern time, it's okay with me. Will you choose not to despise prophesying if God chooses to speak in this way? And finally, and most certainly, will you test all things and hold fast to what is good? Will that be your decision with me today? Is that fair enough to ask you? And again, the material will be on the table. We have a drawing to do, don't we, before I leave? And then we'll pray after I do this drawing. Okay. 54798. 54798 has won the prize right over here. Congratulations. Okay, and apparently these announcements were not covered, so before I pray, I'll just reiterate. Wednesday night, I have a regular 6:30 to 7:30 Bible study here in the Family Center. And as I mentioned last night, because the subject of the 2300 days has generated some questions in a number of people and they would like some more information, be happy to have you join me for that study. We'll take it apart and look at it in more detail. So that will be this coming Wednesday night, the 2300 days. Tonight's meeting, don't forget, we still have one more subject to cover in this series, and that's the sin that cannot be forgiven, the unpardonable sin. Matt's class, my cousin Matt Crouch, will be having continuing prophetic studies with some great study guides and some fun and fellowship together each Sabbath morning at about 9:40 or so in the just behind the booth up there on the second floor, and also next Friday night as well. Different subject, but same class meets together in his home, 7 p.m., just south of here, a few miles. There will be maps out here on the table. Tonight, we'll have some CDs available after sundown. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Thank you for this time that we shared together. Thank you, Lord, that you're a God who gives gifts and that you've given every one of us a gift to bring glory and honor to your name, to help evangelize the world, and to help build up the body of Christ. Please give us wisdom as we seek to use the Bible the way that you would have us to put every gift to the biblical test and to have confidence in what proves true. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, folks.